We're here today at the Dell Carnegie Training Japan offices, and I'm joined by Greg Story. Greg, thanks for joining me.
Great pleasure, Chris.
I'm glad we could sit down and talk about business today and a little bit about sales in Japan, and in particular, trends that you've been seeing over the past year, how things are changing a little bit. Before we do that, though, some people listening may not know about Greg's story, so tell us a little bit about yourself.
Oh, about me? Okay. Well, I'm the president of Dell Carnegie Training here in Japan. I've been in this role now for 7 years. Prior to that, I was running an Australian bank here in Japan, and prior to that, I worked for the Shinsei Bank. And then prior to that, I was working in the Australian Embassy doing trade promotion. Originally, I was going to be an academic. I got a PhD in Japanese decision making, particularly Japan-China relations, which is very topical at the moment. My original interest in Japan came through my study of Japanese karate when I was growing up in Australia, and that's really the core driver for me to come to Japan. But I actually turned out spending 30 years here
right.
in Japan, you know, which I never planned. So if I'd known I was going to be here for 30 years, I probably would have planned it a bit better. But this is my third time in Japan. This time, I've been here 25 years continuously, both in Nagoya, or not both, but in Nagoya, in Osaka, and Tokyo now. So it's been a long run, and I'm going to be here for a long time.
You never imagined when you were taking those karate lessons that you would end up here for 3 decades.
No, I didn't, but I came because I could never work out my Japanese teacher, you know. Everything culturally was always around the wrong way to me, and I thought, if I'm going to master the art of karate, I have to understand how the Japanese think.
Right.
And the way to do that is come here. And that's actually how it worked out. I did understand. And then things became very much clearer for me. And I could master the art eventually.
Well, that translates over to business and sales, because now you understand how Japanese think, Japanese culture, and you can translate that into sales success and also help other businesses be more successful in this market. So let's talk about that a little bit. You talk to a lot of clients all the time through Dell Carnegie training. So you're hearing about how business is going, you're hearing about problems or concerns that they might have, and of course successes as well. So what are you hearing from clients these days?
Yeah, there's a few issues that are occupying clients. One of them is succession planning. We have all the baby boomers basically getting into retirement age in the next decade or so. And so who's going to replace them? And how capable will they be for the challenges that are coming up in this, you know, next decade or so of business? And that relates to training. Obviously, as a training company, we're talking to people about those issues. So how to get the middle management ready for senior management, how to keep a lot of senior people engaged because they can't afford to let them retire. They can't let that expertise just walk out the door. So yes, they're going to have like a second life of leadership in the company, but leading in a different way. And so trying to prepare seniors for leading for another 10 years or so with a quite different environment to what they grew up in. The other things I think are relating to Japan's problem with not enough young people coming into the system.
Mm-hmm.
So you're going to have a shortage of them. They're going to become like free agents in baseball. You're going to see a lot more Japanese youth mobility in work than we've seen in previous generations, simply because there aren't demographically enough of them.
Yeah.
The ages of 10 to 34, from 2010 to 2060, in that period, it halves. So that's a big drop off, actually. And so, therefore, young people are going to have a lot more power in terms of being retained by companies than in the past. And so, who really is the linchpin to making sure they don't walk out the door and go to their competitor? It's the middle management. So, middle management's got to scale up to take on senior leadership in the future. They've also got to realign and manage young people who are actually different in terms of their expectations, and their mobility is going to be much higher. So that's one element. Another element is the demographics of declining consumer base in Japan means that for a lot of companies, they have to go offshore and have buying companies offshore or establishing businesses offshore to have the right market size. So that brings in another dimension of really great difficulty of having to run a matrixed global operation. Once upon a time, you could just send the Japanese managers offshore and that'd be fine. except there's not going to be enough Japanese managers to send offshore anymore. So they're going to have to develop a different type of system. So many companies are looking at how we can develop our management as a global team. And that, again, communication, integration of systems, whole raft of issues there. So these are some things. Engagement comes up a lot in terms of how can we get our Japanese team to be more innovative, more creative. And if you're not engaged, well, you don't care. You know, if you don't engage, you don't care about innovation or creativity. You just keep doing the job the same way. But companies, it's such a competitive environment. They've got to have that creativity. Again, it comes back to that middle management's role in getting creativity out of the team, getting innovation out of the team, and having the engagement part there to make sure that people actually care. So there's some of the things that are occupying companies.
So engagement would help with the mobility issue to some extent, exactly. Of course, right? And as you were talking there, I was thinking about the fact that traditionally in Japan, you join a company and you stay there in the past your whole career, essentially. But now younger people are moving around a lot more, as they have in America and Australia and other countries for a long time. Are you hearing from clients that there are particular challenges associated with keeping those younger people involved long enough to move them to middle management so that you can keep that chain going that you're talking about to take over in the future?
I think the issues come down to communication with those young people, because the middle management group were brought up on a different diet of leadership, of tough love, highly hierarchical, also rather rigid, rule-based. Young people look at their parents' generation and they see there's no job guarantee anymore, because after the Lehman shock, a lot of people were laid off, and that sort of job for life aspect is really going away. And they see that and they think, wow, okay, I could be laid off. Maybe I don't have the guarantee of lifetime employment anymore. So maybe I need to think about things differently. And also, their expectations around the pace that they're going to be promoted through in the company may be different. So the manager's job is to really get them involved in understanding there is a career. They shouldn't go anywhere. They can have the opportunity to develop inside the company. They may have to be a little bit more patient than they think they need to be. They need to get a lot more feedback, a lot more praise and feedback and recognition than their managers ever got. They didn't get anything, really. But they want that. They want to know, am I doing a good job? How am I going? So a lot of switching of gears is going to be involved here on the manager's side to keep them inside, to keep the retain part. Recruit will be one element, but retain will be another very big element. And that's something that the company can control itself, really. Once you've got them inside, it's up to you to get them in the right culture of the company, have them feel that they've got a future there, to feel that they shouldn't look at the grass on the other side of that fence and say, that looks greener to me, I'll go there, and think, well, no, it's not actually any greener. This is where I have a future. Communication issues right there, coaching issues by their managers right there, getting willing cooperation as a leader as opposed to, well, I'm the boss, do what I say, my way or the highway, that's going to go away.
So what are the ramifications for businesses if they're not successful in holding on to this talent and finding a way to incorporate those expectations that young people have into their business?
Well, it's going to stunt their growth. In some cases, it may put them out of business. Because if you haven't got the supply of talent, or the supply of talent you're getting isn't good enough, and your competitor's getting the talent, and you're not, eventually they'll put you out of business. They'll be more creative, more flexible, more capable, and you won't be. The other thing is the costs. Now, what they'll be doing is they'll be coming the training ground for their competitors, because they'll bring them in at university, they'll train them for 3 or 4 years, and then they'll quit.
Right.
Now, you don't get to reap the reward of that investment that you've made in those young people. They've gone to your competitor, and your competitor gets that. So if you're able to poach the best talent, then over time, you will win the game. Because it's a man-on-man, woman-on-woman competition, really, out there in the marketplace. So the quality of your team versus the quality of your competitor's team decides everything. Now, it doesn't decide it in one day, but over time it does. And then also, how are you going to supply that succession planning they talked about before? Where is the succession line going to come from? If you're getting turnover, they're never going to get up into those lower levels of management, middle levels of management, to then succeed to higher levels of management. You're going to be losing them. So that disruption, you know, you're losing money on the recruiting, you're losing money on the dislocation of people not staying there, and you're losing money through time, because when new people come in, you're back to square one. So you're losing a couple of years of training before you get the opportunity to have the investment pay something back to you. So I think there's a lot of cost involved in that, and also just the pure dislocation. And that affects motivation. That affects how everyone else in the company feels about the future of that business. Oh, wow, are we going to be okay?
Right.
Is this going to be safe here? Or maybe, you know, people are leaving. I can't see how this is going to work. Maybe I should leave now and get a job while I still can. So, you know, it's got a lot of ramifications for companies.
Well, companies have to evolve as well. And for that, you need fresh ideas. So you need the younger people coming in. And as you're saying, if you bring them in when they're young, they stay 3 years, then they jump to somewhere else. Your management is aging, and you end up with a void in that middle section, right? Do you find that some companies maybe take too long to recognize that that's happening and react to that?
Oh, absolutely. Because, you know, you can buy fiat. You can say, okay, middle managers, from now on, you're going to be warm, caring, considerate, great coaches, great communicators. You're really going to make those people feel valued in the company. You're going to keep them. Well, you can say that. You can sit up in the corporate headquarters, you know, on the top floor of the building, in the sort of, you know, very quiet, lush carpet, dark wood paneled offices, and make those demands on your middle management. But if your middle management doesn't get it, then they just ignore it. If your middle management doesn't have the skill sets, and this is as a training company where we come in, they don't know how to do it. They might say, well, intellectually, I get it, but practically, I don't know what to do. I don't know what I've got to say to these young people. I don't know how to coach people. I don't know how to praise people, really. Good job. Well, good job. Is that really praise? Well, I do many things. Which part of the many things I'm doing was the good part?
Right.
So it's got to be specific. You've got to, even something as simple as how to praise someone has got something to it, there's a structure to it. Recognize the thing they did that was good. You know, make that very clear. This is what you did. Tell them how that fits into the big picture of the company, because often people feel, well, I'm just a little cog in a big machine. I can't see where my input makes a difference. That's the manager's job, to tell them where your input makes a difference. Recognize that part that you did and the ramifications that has for the business, and encourage them to keep doing that and tell them there's a future there. So this is intellectually something you can understand, but doing it is a different measure. And this is where we find in the training, we can explain it in the training, and people will go, oh yeah, good. Then we get to the role play. Mm-hmm. Often they're rubbish. You know, they're hopeless because it's the first time to do it. And so naturally, first time to do it, they're not very good. So that's where they need the coaching and the training. They need the repetition and the training. They need to hear other people, what they're saying and how that's working. So, oh, that's good. I'll copy that. That's good. I guess I like that. And do it over and over again. And then gradually, they get very good at it. They get very confident with it. They get skilled. Same with the coaching. How to coach people, you know, same with the performance assessments. Nobody likes performance assessments because they're not motivational. Everyone feels, I didn't enjoy that as an exercise. I didn't get anything out of that. This is on both sides. This is the manager and the person being managed. So everyone feels it's really a disincentive. They don't see, oh, this is me developing my career in this company to go forward, and here's an element of giving me feedback that's going to help me to work out, you know, what I need to do next. It's all demotivational. So, you know, how to handle mistakes, all these sorts of things. And managers, how to delegate, how you can free up your time to concentrate on the most high-value tasks that only you should be doing by delegating tasks to others, so the people being delegated to don't feel, oh, my managers came and dumped all their work on my shoulders.
Get rid of that thing they didn't want to do.
I'm already busy. Why do I need your job? I can't do my own job. As opposed to, this is going to help you prepare for a chance for you to step up into a senior role by getting parts of a senior role now while you're at this level to experience what that's like, what that is like, and get some sense of how to do those things, so that when it gets time to consider people, we know oh, you already have experience in those areas, that's going to make you a more attractive candidate than somebody else. So they've got to see how to delegate properly, because the vast majority of managers don't delegate. You know, and so it's a time problem for them, because they don't know how to delegate, they don't have time to coach, they don't have time to communicate properly. It's a vicious circle.
Right. Let's roll back for just a moment, because we're talking about how to train young people coming in. But you said earlier that you bring in young people from university, they stay in the company like 3 years, you train them, and then they go to your competitor, or they go to another company that maybe you're not in direct competition with, but you've been a training ground for them. And some people listening to this in the United States or in many other parts of the world might be thinking that, yeah, that sounds completely familiar. That's very normal. But in Japan, that's not normal traditionally. It's becoming more normal now, and so it's a unique challenge that companies in Japan are facing that, again, may sound familiar to people outside Japan, but here it's something that I'm sure you have to help Japanese clients cope with and adjust to.
You know, that's not a problem when you have demographics working in your favor. Job mobility, when you've got plenty of people, is a good thing. And that's what you find in most of the Western advanced countries, where population demographics are not as stringent an issue as they are in Japan. However, when you're running out of people in the sense of coming into the workforce, and as I said, from the year 2010 to 2060, the age 0 to 34 is halving over that period of time. What does that tell you? That tells you that you've got a problem here of not being able to recruit enough people for your business. So that's where it becomes an issue. So retaining people becomes much harder. Now, in high job mobility environments, it's a good way to refresh talent. It's a good way to get better people in, attract higher quality people, and move people who are not performing out. But in Japan, traditionally, there wasn't a lot of mobility at all. And you might say, oh, great, we've got greater job mobility. If you can retain them, mm-hmm. You know, great that somebody else is training them for you, because you've got the right system here to retain them, and they don't then move on somewhere else. This is the issue. If you can do that, you're really going to be a winner. But you just can't assume that job mobility in itself, well, so what? Because it's, you know, that's a great thing. Well, in Japan, that's not going to be a great thing, because you want to have job mobility, but then you want to have no job mobility after that, because you've got them. So it's a little bit trickier here, I think.
Let me ask you about something else related to demographics that's come up recently. Now, Japan is a country that isn't known for immigration. And I would say, generally, they're a bit averse to having immigrants come in. However, recently the government announced that they are going to fast-track permanent residency for highly skilled workers. And in this case, after 1 year, someone who's considered a highly skilled worker, you have to meet certain qualifications, can apply for permanent residency after 1 year. Do you think that this is potentially a way in the midterm, the long term, that Japanese companies might be able to sort of fill that gap of a declining population and a drop in the number of workers that are available coming out of universities here?
I would say no. I would say it's not going to work. And when you look at the Japanese strategic approach to this problem of a demographic decline, aging population, they're putting a lot of emphasis on robotics, you know, and AI, you know, artificial intelligence, these sorts of things, to be a labor substitute. Harmony in the Japanese society is highly valued. And that harmony is something, I think, that they put a greater value on than having migration. And so you can see this strategic direction of a lot of investment in robotics and artificial intelligence, etc. That's on one side. Yes, they're asking for skilled people to come here, and they're giving them more years to get here. That's great. But on the other side, you've got the Japanese finance ministry, who looks after the taxation system, bringing in quite stiff inheritance tax rules. Right. The exit tax, they've improved the original draft of that so that it doesn't hit you straight away. But there are taxation implications for foreigners to come and work here, that you are automatically up for inheritance tax on maybe one of your parents passes in your home country and you inherit. Well, the Japanese government will want to tax that. So for a lot of people, that's like, wow, okay, I'm not so sure I want to go and work there because my parents are aging and I don't want to give the Japanese government, you know, a big chunk of that. So also, if you're selling property overseas, they're treating you as a permanent resident, even if your visa is not a permanent resident. You're a permanent resident for taxation purposes. So if you sell property overseas, the Japanese government wants to claim the capital gains tax on that. If it's you know, if your own country's capital gains tax is less than the Japanese taxation rate, which is 20%, say yours is 15, there's a 5% difference there. They want that 5%. So I'm just saying there are a number of things working at odds against itself within the Japanese system to get a lot of foreigners to want to come here and work here. Now, if you want factory workers, if you want labourers for construction sites, which they do, if you want retail workers in shops and that type of thing, yes, they could probably deal with that. They could probably have short-term stay. The nursing program, lack of nurses, healthcare, aged care, all these sorts of things, they could probably get a workaround for a lot of that. But I'm sure most of those people will be on a type of visa that they will be able to be moved out again because they want to keep that domestic harmony.
Right.
So, you know, for the very high level end areas that our companies are tending to deal with and getting workers for that, I think that will be a partial fix, but not a full fix.
Interesting views. Well, let's talk about a few other areas of the training that you do with Dale Carnegie. So you train both gaishike, multinational companies, and also domestic Japanese companies. What are some of the differences that you see? And again, we're talking about their operations in Japan, but there may be multinational companies operating here versus domestic companies. What kind of differences do you see there?
Yeah, because we're a training company, we tend to be dealing with a lot of people in learning and organizational development or the HR function. Sometimes we get to deal with line managers directly. The biggest difference I can see between Japanese domestic companies and multinationals is the function of HR. In a Japanese domestic company, the function of HR is a type of internal police function. Oh, Chris, you were late for work. Oh, you didn't fill out the form when you took your leave. Now we're going to rotate you around the company to the next stage in your career as a generalist, right? So there's not really the concept of developing people apart from this job rotation through on-the-job training. In foreign multinational companies, they see training as a way to fast-track people and have the succession planning to get the skills in place. The jobs are not so much generalist as more specialist. So you're not going to rotate your way around the company to learn something. You're going to be in functional specialities, which need special skills, and therefore you need special training. Often that's technical training, but increasingly it's also soft skills training. So the HR function, the learning and organizational development function, see to themselves as a partner to the functional parts of the business. That's the big difference. So when we go and talk to them in the foreign multinationals, they get it. They get it straight away. They say, oh, Dale Carnegie. Yeah, we're a global company. We're dealing with Dale Carnegie in some of the 100 countries around the world that you're covering. We know who you are. Yes, we know who Dale Carnegie is. We know the company's formed 105 years ago, been here 54 years. They've got that idea that we are a long-term global player. So the acceptance is much faster. They see what we do works. The decision-making much quicker. With a Japanese company, it tends to be, oh, well, we do on-the-job training. But...
And when they say that, they mean by on-the-job training, you're talking about rotating people through the company.
Yes.
So they gain different skills
yes.
by playing different roles
yes.
for a year
yes.
and then a year here and a year there.
Yeah. Well, a couple of years here and there. So what it means is the people delivering the coaching and training are their bosses. Now, if your bosses were really outstanding practitioners and great communicators and great coaches, this would be great. However, what's happened with the bosses? They're often not delegating, so they're time poor. They're not great time managers, time poor. They're short cutting everything, they're stressed out. They're not giving you the time and attention. They're not giving you the real coaching you need. They're just letting you work it out yourself. You know, it's a bit like the Japanese food industry. If you're becoming a chef in Japan, the chefs don't teach the junior chefs anything. You've got to go over and lick the bowl after the chef's created something and try and work out what was that combination of flavors that produced that taste. You know, you've got to watch what they're doing and try and observe and copy that. There's not a lot of instruction. That's a very traditional way of learning things, right? Now, the problem with that is, as I say, as the seniors are coming out of the system and the succession planning kicks in as a problem, they're not going to be there to coach you anyway. And by the way, they're time poor, they're not coaching now, regardless. So how do you learn? And so what you're getting is mediocrity passed on generation after generation after generation. Now, at some stage in the post-war period, that sort of worked. However, we're getting to a point now where, you know, we've sort of got all the, you know, everything out of that. We've got all the juice out of that. There's no more juice left. Right. It's done. And they need to have higher levels of performance, which means the skill levels have to go up on the people who are doing the jobs. That means real training. And Japanese domestic companies are coming to that realization. We've run everything we can out of it. We can't get any more out of that system. We need to introduce better systems, more advanced systems, more effective systems that actually give us a performance outcome. The other problem is, and this is all training, unless the training itself has an element to bring people out of their comfort zone, the training often, no matter how good it is not adopted by the participants in the training and become their new default. What happens is they go to the training, they get downloaded a whole bunch of information, it goes in here, one ear, out the other ear, doesn't stick, and worse than that, when they go back to their workspace or their workstation or whatever, they're not changing what they're doing before. There's no behavior change, there's no adoption of the learning. So what was the point? So Dale Carnegie found this, you know, 100 years ago, that just giving people information doesn't work. It's how you impart the information. How do you get ownership of the information? How do you get them to take that information and adopt it? How do you get them to make their comfort zone larger so they're prepared to take a risk of the new and prepared to make a change for the better? Unless that element is in the training, nothing happens. And this is the problem. Even Japanese companies, even Goshke companies, foreign and internationals, who've got internal training, if the training doesn't have that capacity, they're wasting their time.
And you mentioned at the beginning there that multinational companies, they know Dale Carnegie and they buy into what you're explaining more easily. How much work does it take you to get a Japanese company to buy into this? Like, you can explain it to them like you've just explained here. And you mentioned when they come for training, when their staff come for training, it's in one ear, out the other. But of course, in the moment, they're probably hearing you and they're saying, oh, that makes sense. But when they leave, then they're not applying it, right? Getting the management of a Japanese domestic company to buy into this concept in Dale Carnegie and take seriously what you're offering, how much more difficult is that?
Yes, a lot more difficult. A lot more difficult. And yes, you're right. Intellectually, when we explain about comfort zone, they get it. We talk about the issues, they get it. The trouble is, they're very conservative. No one gets rewarded in a Japanese company for taking a risk. You get demerits for making a mistake. How do you not make a mistake? Do nothing new.
Never take a risk.
Never take a risk. Never make any changes. You know, steady as she goes. So there's a real contradiction between what they need to be doing and what they're actually doing in terms of how they evaluate people. So we have to get them to see to believe. You know? So often what we'll do is we'll say to the learning and organization development people or the HR people, come and do the course yourself. Now, once they experience our training and they see the behavior change of their classmates and themselves, when they see that coming out of the comfort zone, it's built into the training. Things we talked about, they see it in reality, then they understand, then they realize, oh my God, what we're doing hasn't any of that, even with the multinational companies. Yes, we've got globally designated training or we've even localized it in Japan, but our trainers aren't anywhere near as good as these data planning trainers. Our training is just information crossover. It's not got anything in there to have behavior change. That's when the penny drops and they start to realize, oh, wow, this is a totally different game here, and we're not part of it. And that's when they see the value. So it's much longer and harder, and you've just got to be very patient, and you've got to keep going. And it often happens, we have our consultants get together once a week, we have a meeting. I'm sitting there, and often I'll hear, oh, now we've got so-and-so as a new client. Great, we met them 4 years ago.
Right.
We met them 3 years ago. You know, often happens, 3 or 4 year gestation period.
Yeah.
Of constant attention before they'll do it. And then, you know, even some cases, and this drives me nuts, I can tell you, where we had a case recently. We had the president of a company, it's a major, major manufacturer. He came and did our high impact presentations course, blew him away. It was like, unbelievable course, I love this, fantastic. I want this for my team. Goes back to the company, says, okay, I want this training, I want this Dale Carnegie in here right now, make it happen. The HR function said, oh, I'm not too sure about this, we don't know. They blocked it. In the end, the HR person who was blocking it left the company. But can you imagine that? The president has done the course and said, this is great, I want it, but internal conservatism blocked it. And now it's going to happen. But man, that's elongated the whole process. This often happens. The internal system will reject even senior leadership's direction because they don't want to take a risk. They don't do anything new. And we have to be very sure about this. And, you know. So we have to be patient. We have to explain. We have to get seeing is believing. That's the bottom line. Seeing it means we might send in a trainer to do a demo class inside their company. It might be we put people into our classes to test it, be the HR people or just people in the course. We can show them testimonial videos. We can let them come and watch, but it's until they experience it that they don't probably believe it. So, yes, it can be done, but boy, it takes time and it's hard work. The Geishke multinational companies, they get it. They understand, right, we need high performance. We need it now on that course. Make it happen. Work it out, you know.
And if the president says, let's do it,
it happens.
It happens. Well, suppose that a CEO has just arrived in Japan and they have to familiarize themselves with the culture, how business is done here, and of course, how to prepare their team to be as successful as they possibly can in business in Japan and globally. What advice would you have for them?
Okay. The analogy, or maybe analogy, metaphor, I would have is when you're new to Japan, it's like you've landed and now you're swimming in this big lake, quite warm, not cold water, it's warm, swimming around. Unfortunately, the lake is covered in a very heavy fog and you can hear sounds and you can sort of make out indiscriminate things in the distance there, but you can't really see it clearly. And so you're swimming around in this fog. And then after a couple of years, the fog starts to lift a little bit. Oh, that's an island. Oh, that's a shore over there. And when things actually clear, your company then transfers you to your next post or your next country. So how do you make that whole thing faster?
Yeah.
Well, I think working very closely with your HR organizational development people is very key. And don't just trust the system as it exists to deliver to what you want. You come in, you observe very carefully where you are today, think about what's missing, about where you want to be, and try and find training, hopefully us, to come in and fix that. Because even if you've got centrally designated training from headquarters, that's a global system, often it has variable success in Japan. Often it's delivered in English. Often it's delivered from the training hub for APAC, which is usually Singapore or Hong Kong.
Mm-hmm.
Often the Singapore or Hong Kong team are very fast Chinese speakers of English with an accent. They come here to Japan, a country not renowned for its English skills. So you've got Japanese will be in those classes. They will get through the morning, just. They get to lunch. After lunch, they're going to get maybe 10%, 20%.
They're very tired.
They're tired. They're done.
Yeah.
Morning killed them. their concentration shot, they just can't handle it. And you can tell, and I know this, I've been in these organizations where I've seen this, you can tell that an employee of these multinationals, you can tell the Chinese trainers, hey, listen, you got to slow down. Or you can tell the Western trainers, drop all the sporting
analogies
and okay. idioms, right?
Yeah.
Drop all idioms. Speak more slowly. They take notice for about the first second. They can't break the habit, you know. Or then you've got interpretation involved. And then the time gets lost because they can't control the time anymore because
yeah.
it's geared up for something in English. They are really not skilled people for a Japanese environment. And even if you've got Japanese localization and you're delivering it in Japanese, how good are those Japanese trainers? They're okay, oh, here's this trainer manual. We're going to download the trainer manual content. Nothing about comfort zone expansion, nothing about behavior change. And they're not very good trainers either. And then the central training has to be a pillar that can be moved all around the world. So you get the lowest common denominator of need globally. And as we know, every location will have certain things that are specific to that location, which central headquarters will never cover in a million years because they're not a training company. And they will not spend the money developing training for just Japan, for those specific things which are outliers. But those outliers are often very critical for the Japanese entity, but there's no cure for that. So what do? You know, you just keep going and you're not really getting the quality. So as the head of the business, look at that. Look very carefully at it. If you've got central training, how is it organized? What is the quality of the people who are actually delivering this? What languages are being... I was at a networking function recently. I met a lady. She's a president of her company. She told me, oh, you've got centralized training for sales. I'm like, oh, that's great. What language is it? English. I mean, you've got to be kidding me.
And the sales team are mostly Japanese.
And they're selling in Japanese to Japanese buyers. Mm. You've got to be kidding me. How can you train Japanese team members to sell in Japanese to a Japanese buyer by training them in English? How can the coach coach them? Sales is what you say and how you say it. How can you coach them on how they're saying it? You can't. So that's just a total joke. But you'd be surprised. There are so many companies like that. But really, they just don't get it. If you're a newly arrived CEO here, get it. Work out, hey, that's not going to fly. We need to get this training in Japanese. We need to not have the Japanese get 60% in the morning and 10% in the afternoon. We need 100% all day long. We need to have behavioral change. We need to have high quality because we've got performance outcomes. We've got targets we need to reach. I've only got limited time here. I need to get the best for my people. And I've got to, and if you need help to work out what that is, then find help. Again, I'm plugging my own company here, but that's why we're here. We can help the CEOs to solve those problems because we've seen this a million times before. This is not new to us.
But crafting training that allows the person being trained to have 100% concentration throughout the day, that's an art that lies on the side of the trainer
yep.
and crafting the plan, right? Because, I mean, for any of us, an all-day activity is going to drain us over time, right? So you have to have a plan in how you train and an approach that allows you to keep everyone engaged and fresh
absolutely
through the day, right? And that probably typically doesn't happen with internal training in a company.
Monotone delivery,
yeah,
energyless delivery, one pattern,
mm-hmm.
one-way delivery, that's the most common. What does our training look like? Highly interactive. The trainers, they've got to get the team who walk in the door at probably 20 to 30% energy levels up to 100%. That means the trainers are operating at 140, 150% energy levels. I can tell you, when I'm training, or any of us are training in Dale Carnegie, we never take our jackets off. You know why? We're soaked underneath. Shirts are soaked.
Imagine.
We don't wear colored shirts,
yeah.
white shirts, because we're operating 140, 150 energy. Because we get the energy levels up to 100. And we've got this change of pace, you know, self-work, you know, think and write, small group activity, reporting, big group activity, okay, exercises, role play, down, you know, looking at some information. It's that constant variety that keeps people engaged. And it's so different. People say to us, wow, I've never seen anything like this before. And that's right, they haven't. Because the typical Japanese training is, the sensei, the instructor comes in, blah, 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 all day, one way, maybe a little bit of, a little bit of group work, no passion, nothing. It's just a killer. And that's why when you say to Japanese staff, oh, we're going to send you to training, they don't see that as a step up.
Mm-hmm.
They see that as some negative reflection on their current state of their ability and capability and punishment, because it's going to be boring. So they're not enthusiastic. And, you know, we get this. We get people, you know, you've seen it. They lean back in the chair, got the arms folded. Why am I here? This is a waste of time. I've got better things to do with this. I can't see any point to this. They're negative when they come in the room. This happens all the time with Japanese companies and sometimes Geishke companies too, multinational companies too. But we're experienced. We've been here for 54 years. Not the first time, you know, to be in our rodeo. We know how to deal with that. We turn that attitude around. We turn around straight away because we know we can't have a whole bunch of hostages or saboteurs in the class. We've got to get people activated. So there are techniques for that. But coming back to your CEO example, look very carefully at what you've got, what you need, and then go and find the resource. Even if it's not us, find the resource that's going to deliver you the outcomes that you want, because what your current system is delivering may not do that. Because often when I find Japanese companies using training and they're using a company I've never even heard of for leadership training, I say, well, who are these people? Oh, they're very small team. Why use it? Well, you know, the guy knew, the guy from that company. Typical Japan, right? It's not logical, it's emotional, it's relationships. It's I know so-and-so, so we'll bring them in. Are they the best in class? Have they got their own central university producing, you know, IP, national intellectual property? Have they got activities in 100 countries around the world? Are they teaching in 30 languages? Have they been going for 100 plus years? Have they been going for 50 plus years in Japan like we have? No, but it doesn't matter because they know so-and-so, therefore they're in here. So they're not getting the optimum level of expertise they could be getting. It's relationship. And that's why for us it's often hard to break in, because those relationships are there, even though what we give them would be so far superior. So yes, it's hard, but keep your eyes open and look around and search out best in class, no matter what it is, look for best in class.
One last thing that I'm hearing there, taking away from this, is that as a CEO coming to Japan, keep in mind that those small cultural specific elements of training that may seem unimportant may be some of the most important elements, right?
Absolutely. And I think we've got 40 Japanese trainers. We teach in English as well. So we have native speaker trainers for whichever languages. We found, even though our non-native speaker trainers can speak very fluent Japanese as foreigners, 10% of the people who give us feedback as participants will complain. Oh, they made a mispronunciation of a word. Oh, they had a grammatically incorrect sentence. Or I couldn't understand what they were saying. They're the ones who will tell you. So there's probably a larger group who won't tell you, but will think that. Because Japanese are very picky as a consumer of services. They want perfection. So we don't mix it up unless we've got some need for a dual language training. So they want it in both languages. So Japanese training, Japanese native speakers. English training, English native speakers is the way we go to get around those sorts of problems. So there are those sort of cultural things. And so naturally, the Japanese trainers, even though they're teaching a curriculum that's based out of the Dale Carnegie University in America, it's localized when we bring it here. We change the language, but 99% of it is exactly the same content, but it's delivered in a culturally sensitive way with the right language in Japan, so we get around those sorts of problems. Although sometimes people think, oh, it's American. Well, look, we've been here for 54 years. Trust me, we've localized this already. It's not a problem. But people don't know that necessarily, so we've got to make sure they do that.
Yeah. Well, last topic to talk about a little bit here. We talked about multinational companies here a moment ago. And we live in an age of globalization, and Japanese companies are looking to become more globalized. What are you hearing in terms of efforts that Japanese companies are making on that front, and how does training play into globalization efforts in those companies?
Yeah, we're doing more training of expat Japanese managers who will work offshore. And it's not cultural training only, it's people skill training. Because if you look at Dale Carnegie's book, How to Win Friends and Influence People, it works around 30 human relations principles, which are universal. These are straight up universal. We know that because we teach in 100 plus countries. We've been doing this for 100 plus years. It works everywhere. We know that. So if your people skills are very, very strong, then no matter what country you go to, you will do well. Yes, there are cultural differences between countries, and you're going to become aware of those, but your fundamental people skills is a key thing. So they're seeing that as a need. We're also seeing the headquarters staff being trained, because in a matrix organization now, someone could be leading a functional unit, but based in a foreign country, who's doing it in English. So it's not just a matter of, well, I don't have to worry about that because I'm a Japanese employee in Japan. Changing. Even the Japanese employees based in Japan are interacting more with the foreign entity. So they've got to get up to speed on how to deal with that too. And it's even simple things like, particularly in foreign national companies where the Japanese don't participate in the phone conference. They don't participate in the video conference. They don't participate when the visiting VIPs come to Japan. And headquarters complains because they say, you know what? The Japanese are not contributing. The Japanese are not engaged. The Japanese are not adding any value. Well, the Japanese are as smart as anyone. They've got all the right experience. What they have, though, is a huge barrier around the ability to speak up in English in those meetings and question how to have an opinion, how to disagree with someone else's opinion, how to make an intervention, how to jump in and cut the conversation.
So some of it is business culture as well.
Yeah, it's straight up. So training people on how to do that is an element. So we have to train them on how to do these things. So we're doing both preparing people to go overseas, but also people who are here. And we're training them in certain skill sets beyond, oh, just English. Well, look, English is one element, but there's a lot more needed than just English. And this is what I think companies recognize. Now, some Japanese companies are spending a fortune. They're shipping their young people off to their foreign branches for a year. That's a huge amount of money.
Yeah.
But they want to internationalize them and get them up to speed in English. And they're prepared to spend that sort of money. Others can't afford to spend that sort of money. So they're trying to do it here or before they go. So it varies. In some cases, we, because we're around the globe, we can take the training that's developed in Japan and replicate that same training in Thai, you know, in Indonesian, in Chinese, in Korean, you know, wherever it might be, throughout the world, in French, in Finnish, whatever it is. And companies find that a big advantage. They can design training in Japan and then export that training for their organization all around the world and know that the same consistency of delivery is going to be there, with the same content that's, you know, agreed to and developed jointly, and they're going to get an immediate lift globally at the same time instead of, you know, all over the place. That's a big advantage too. So we're doing that for a lot of companies where we're taking the centrally developed training in Japan and taking it global.
But when you do that, and let's say it's developed in Japan with you, and then it's for their staff in Indonesia, Thailand, and Korea, mm-hmm. it's being taught by Dale Carnegie trainers
yes.
in Indonesia, Thailand,
so Dale
and Korea.
Carnegie Indonesia, Dale Carnegie Thailand, Dale
yeah.
Carnegie Korea.
It's not just the material, but
no,
it's also the trainers.
Yeah, they are local trainers, expert in their particular countries, in their languages. But the IP, the intellectual property, the content is common.
Mm-hmm.
So a delegation unit, how to do delegation properly, is exactly the same in every country, but taught differently based on culture and language
right.
in those countries. But the basic content, exactly the same. So here's the structure, here's the things, you know, here's the coaching. So that's a big advantage for companies, and they really are appreciating that, you know, and they're using it.
Well, if someone wants to find out more about Dale Carnegie training and apply it to their company, what's their next step?
Well, contact me, greg.story@dalecarnegie.com. That's my email address. You can find me on LinkedIn. I've got nearly 500 articles
Greg.
On LinkedIn.
You
can find
everywhere.
My address there. You can just give us a call here in our office in Tokyo. Or
yeah.
Our website is www.japan.dalecarnegie.com. Find us there. You can have a look on our website. We've got a lot of stuff, free stuff there. Look us up because, you know, we'll tell you. If we can't help, we'll tell you straight up. And say, well, that's not us. We can't do that. You know, we don't waste anybody's time. If we've got the solution for you, we'll explain it to you, and then it's up to you what you do about it, but if we can help you, we'll try and help you.
I should also mention that you write a lot, you publish a lot on LinkedIn, so people are interested in just getting more advice like you shared today.
Yeah.
That's a great place to go.
Yeah, well, I'm putting out advertorial content in all the major chamber magazines, like ACCJ Journal, Acumen Journal. I'm doing Facebook, Twitter, and LinkedIn posts every day. I post Japanese and I post English separately. I'm doing 3 podcasts a week, one on leadership, one on sales, and one on presentation skills. Leadership in Japan, leadership for Japan, sales for Japan, presentation skills for Japan. So it's Japan-oriented. I'm doing that, and it's all free. This is out there, so if people want to get access to that, I say you've got 500 articles on LinkedIn, Facebook, and Twitter. I've got nearly 200 podcasts on leadership, up to number 23 on sales and presentation skills for Japan. There's a lot of information there, and it's all free. So if people like to take advantage of that, subscribe and see if it helps. I mean, you know, if you don't think it's useful, fine, but I think you'll find it's useful because I'm writing for the foreign staff member, boss in Japan, dealing in the Japanese reality. That's my ideal consumer of my content. That's what I'm writing for. And I'm basing it on my own experience, I'm basing it on my clients' experiences, and I'm basing it on the Dale Carnegie IP, intellectual property that we have, and all the things we cover. So it's a mixture of those things.
Excellent. Well, Greg, thanks again for all your time today. I really appreciate it.
Great pleasure, Chris. Thank you very much. And I look forward to getting together with you, and maybe we do a podcast in the future.
Yeah, we should.
Thanks.